audience is clapping for you all. Clapping for you all. Well, thank you, Larry. We've come a long way since the joint staff, and it's a real pleasure to be here. And thank you, Secretary Peters. I appreciate your service to AFA and to the Air Force. I, for one, have been a member, and I know Larry has checked this fact, since 1985 when my squadron commander ordered me to be. So I just encourage all of you who are not members to join this great organization. So I want to say a few more thank yous before we get started. Our chief, General Goldfein, and it is hard to see, I see you right there. I learn from you every day. It's a real honor to stand beside you, and I'm really proud to serve with you. So thank you for everything. I want to give a shout out to Chief Wright, our new Chief Master Sergeant of the Air Force. I thought your comments on character yesterday were spot on, and I look forward to working with you. MAJCOM Commanders and Hawk. I think Hawk, I think I can say this, I'm the only secretary to have served working for you in uniform. We'll miss you, and Diz and I look forward to a lot of great times in your retirement, so thank you. To our joint partners out there, and our international partners, thank you for being here. Allies, civic leaders, and particularly the airmen who are here. Thank you for showing your blue uniform today to this conference. It's really important that you're here. And thank you for all you do. And thank you for your service and for all your families do. Thanks to many mentors I've seen over the course of the couple days I've been here. Too many to mention. General Jumper's here. I want to say thank you. General Welsh is here. Thank you for being one of my mentors. General Winwa is here. Thank you. And I particularly want to thank, before I get started, our industry partners, because it's you who've developed the world's most capable and best-equipped Air Force. You bring us the solutions we need. And Chief, I will accept the marble. So I want to get started with what is really a walk across the Air Force from a business perspective. I want to talk about the year that we've just completed, 2016, and some of the accomplishments. I want to talk about where we are currently in the business of the Air Force, and I want to give you a look forward for the rest of 2017. So, as you're all aware, we're waiting for our candidate for Secretary of the Air Force to come through the confirmation process. And let me paint a little picture of the Pentagon right now and what the atmosphere is like. There's really a feeling of change in the air. We've got an incredible leader at the helm in Secretary Mattis. It's a real honor to work for Secretary Mattis. He's included the service secretaries in his twice per week staff meeting, which seems like maybe a small thing, but it's incredibly important because we get to hear firsthand commander's intent. And we're saving hours across the Air Force of spin by understanding exactly where the Secretary of Defense is headed. And at the President's request, he's initiated several quick turn reviews. The most comprehensive one will determine the new defense strategy and the force planning construct. Other topics under review will include presidential airlift, the F-35 program, readiness, DoD organizational efficiencies, and our nuclear posture. But the most fundamental review is the one on strategy. This review will set the assumptions for sizing and shaping the Air Force for the future to help meet the nation's objectives. It will establish what we call a force planning construct. This determines the number, the size, the timelines, and the conditions of the conflicts we're expected to prepare for. And it will shape the capability investments for the FY19 through 23 budget cycle. It'll help answer questions like, ready for what, where, and how soon. We're going to participate heavily in the review and ensure that our concerns about the threat environment are well represented. While we've been assured there's no preconceived position going in, I seriously doubt any new strategy will be any less demanding than the current framework of defeat, deny, plus homeland defense, all underpinned by a strong strategic deterrence. You heard General Goldfein describe the 4+1 challenges we're facing. And since we're already short in meeting today's demands, I can say with confidence the United States Air Force must grow. Our top focus is in strength. We need to increase the number of people we have. More people will mean improved operational readiness. Our airmen and civilians are our very best asset. They've been meeting the mission daily in undermanned and overstressed units. We expect to close out the FY17 year with 320,000 active duty members, but we need to increase the number to at least 350,000 over time just to fill our existing units to 100%. And we may need to grow beyond that number in the future, depending on this national strategy that we're working in, defense strategy. Our most acute shortfalls are in maintainers, pilots, acquisition and contracting personnel, cyber experts, and software coders, just to name a few. We need more reserve component and more civilians, too. Our civilian manning has decreased since Desert Storm from 262,000 to 182,000 now. Our civilians are critical members of the team. 92% of them are in the field, at depots, on the flight line, or in hospitals. They're serving proudly in many critical positions. But we also need more aircraft. Since Desert Storm, we reduced our aircraft inventory from 8,600 to 5,500. But in a fight, quantity has a quality all of its own. And as Chairman Dunford recently said, we do not want a fair fight. The aircraft we have on the ramp are too old. Secretary Peters pointed this out yesterday when he mentioned that the average age of our aircraft is 27 years. We need to revitalize the fleet. We need newer aircraft, newer fighters, newer tankers, newer bombers, and we need more RPA. But the Air Force provides much more than conventional power. We also provide a large portion of the nation's nuclear deterrence. In order to provide robust, reliable, flexible, and survivable strategic capabilities, we need to upgrade our legacy bomber platforms. We need to recapitalize our ICBMs, a critical strategic deterrent. They're aging out, and we need to replace them. General Goldfein foot-stomped the values of these missiles yesterday in his comments. And we must ensure the B-21 bomber program proceeds intact and on schedule. With its extended range, stealth, and mixed payload, the B-21 will be able to achieve combatant commanders' desired effects for the most difficult targets. Meanwhile, space is no longer a benign environment. Adversaries continue to develop capabilities to deny our advantage. We must build a resilient space architecture. Our installations also need attention. We fight from our bases, but our bases are vulnerable to power outages and cyber attack. We generate air power from our bases, but based on tight budgets, we've underfunded our facilities for several years. We need new investment to make our bases more resilient to the wide array of threats we're facing. We also need to enhance capabilities. Our adversaries are increasingly lethal at greater distance and with more precision. They're procuring more and more capable air defenses, EW assets, and aircraft. They're procuring intelligence platforms, cyberspace, and counterspace assets. Our adversaries are also stealing our intellectual baselines, and they're planning against critical points of failure in our defense industrial base. But we're watching, and we're working with the interagency on this, and I hope to partner more closely with industry to address these vulnerabilities. Given the growing threat, we need to remember every day that our biggest threat is complacency about the threat. We need to invest in ways to counter the capabilities of potential adversaries, and we need to be ready with capable forces when we're called. In short, we need to work together to strengthen and rebuild the total Air Force. Our force is ready to fight and win today, but airmen need time, and they need available platforms to train for full-spectrum missions. So the Air Force has been working with OSD to submit an FY17 amended budget proposal. The submission is consistent with the FY17 unfunded priority list on the Hill, and it follows the President and the SecDef's rebuilding the force guidance. It'll fill gaps and it'll accelerate our readiness recovery. I'm going to talk a little bit more about that later. But now I want to reflect on the past year from the business side of things. In 2016 and early 2017, after a thorough analysis of options, we announced several significant basing decisions. Joint Base McGuire and Travis were identified as preferred locations for KC-46 main operating bases. Joint Base Fort Worth, Texas was announced as the preferred location for the first reserve F-35 location. Holloman was announced as the preferred location for the interim F-16 FTU. And finally, we announced that Shaw Air Force Base would be the preferred location for MQ-9 mission control element operations. We also released several major requests to industry. I'm going to call these RFPs, requests for proposals, in shorthand, and there are a few. For our new training aircraft, after 18 months of development and extensive industry engagement on TX, we had 800 questions and 1,300 suggestions. We released an RFP in December. The TX program replaces our T-38s, and it's critical for us for fifth-gen training. We also released a draft RFP for the UH-1N replacement. Recapitalizing this fleet will improve our ability to meet strategic and homeland defense missions. We engaged in a robust dialogue with industry to continue the acquisition strategy development, and the engagement has proven very fruitful. As a result of the insights we've learned, we've adjusted the timing of the final RFP to this summer, and we look forward to those proposals. On the JSTARS, an engineering and manufacturing development RFP was released for 3 aircraft with options for low-rate initial production. JSTARS is an important asset for battle management C2 and ground tracking intelligence. We also issued an RFP for C-130H upgrades to ensure full fleet compliance with U.S. and foreign air traffic mandates. And finally, we also released RFPs on the ground-based strategic deterrent and long-range standoff weapon in support of our nuclear enterprise. And after overcoming a few challenges, our KC-46 tanker program is progressing well. We exercised contract options for aircraft lots 1 and 2 for 19 aircraft total. Additionally, in January, we awarded lot 3 for another 15. And while we're talking about good news, I want to mention these milestones. In August, we declared the F-35 IOC. This will enable us to cross into the future with our partners. Airmen, both pilots and maintainers, are raving about F-35's performance. It's a force multiplier. We reached another important milestone when we were granted relief on our RPA op tempo. Last year, the Secretary of Defense agreed to limit the caps to 60, and with this relief, General Carlisle was able to execute a get well plan to reduce stress on crews and grow capability. Also, the B-21 team formally approved a program management baseline and an integrated schedule set forth by industry, and we announced the name Raider, honoring the historic Doolittle Raiders. For our space enterprise, we successfully completed 13 launches. 8 were national security space, 3 were commercial, and 2 were civil. We recently launched the wideband global SATCOM WGS-8. We also launched the 12th and final GPS-3F satellite in February. And additionally, we awarded a contract to SpaceX for the GPS-3 launch service, making it the first competitive contract award for a national security space launch service in over a decade. So as we look forward to 2017, we're facing many challenges. We're still not certain about the budget top line for the FYDP, and we'll be working with OSD over the next several months to relook the FY18 to 22 budget in preparation for submitting it to the Hill early this summer. The chief in my job is to ask for what we need and then prioritize the funding we receive. So what are our investment priorities? What basing decisions are we making this year? What are the major program milestones? So let's start with investment. Our highest investment priority is improving readiness. And as I mentioned earlier, our top piece of this, among many requirements, is to increase in strength. At the same time, we must modernize our aging inventory across all major weapon systems with urgency. This includes acquiring new systems and upgrading existing systems to become more lethal and more survivable. I already talked about F-35, B-21, and KC-46 as top priority acquisition. And as we look at our core capabilities, we know we have gaps. We're investing heavily in upgrades to existing platforms and new systems to increase performance in multiple areas, from targeting to communications to power to survivability. You'll see these priorities in our FY17 budget request and amended request. Those requests include critical pilot production, especially fighter pilots. We're about 1,500 pilots short across the total Air Force, and close to 1,000 of those are active duty fighter pilot requirements. This is a national level crisis. We've also requested fourth and fifth gen aircraft mods, weapon system cyber resiliency, and readiness infrastructure. Our FY17 base budget and OCO request that's already on the Hill includes 43 F-35, 24 MQ-9s, and 15 KC-46s. We're seeking more F-35s. It's in our unfunded priority list on the Hill, and we'll be working together with Congress and the department on that. Third, we need to invest in leap-ahead technologies, including new ways to compile, store, and use data to give us combat advantage. We've asked for additional funds to accelerate prototyping of key technologies. These funds will begin to address our concerns, but we also need to continue to find ways to do things smarter and better. For one thing, we need to help industry. You're our problem solvers. We need to help you better understand our requirements, the what and why behind our requirements documents. Here are some of the other ways we're trying to do things smarter, given our tight budget. We're focusing on expert capability analysis to keep requirements affordable while still asking for what we need. That's finding the knee in the curve on cost. And we've saved millions last year in leveraging cost analysis. We're investing in open systems architectures to make it easier to refresh and replace capabilities and to standardize, wherever possible, the system interfaces and connections. We want to be able to plug and play. To do this, we need to own the technical baseline wherever possible. This practice will help ensure airmen can fully utilize all the information gathered by our platforms. The FY17 NDAA placed emphasis on implementing modular, open system approaches. We're taking a hard look at exactly where and how we can do that. This will allow us to upgrade and refresh technology better and cheaper. We'll continue to leverage flexible contract vehicles where we can, such as other transaction authorities. This creates more agile acquisition, and it opens the door more broadly to all industry partners. We're stronger when we make it easy for a wide range of bidders to compete, so we have multiple options for solutions. In addition, we need to explore off-the-shelf technologies where it makes sense. For example, we're going to explore options for light attack aircraft, bringing that into our inventory mix. We want to see if there's a business case there. We need to look at whether adding a low-price platform that can be used in permissive environments makes sense. This concept could free up higher cost, higher performance platforms from doing low threat missions, which would allow us time to prepare for more complex threats with those assets. It could also help us better absorb new pilots and be useful as we work with allies and partners. A low cost light attack platform has the potential to greatly reduce operating costs while still meeting combatant commanders' demands. Another approach focuses squarely on the future. We want to increase and improve the use of experimentation and prototyping as pathways to identify new operational concepts and capabilities. But as we do that, we must ensure these initiatives can be rapidly and affordably fielded. Our adaptive engine transition program is a good example. This work will help reduce risk to engineering and manufacturing development. The program's on track to improve fuel efficiency by 25% while yielding 10% more thrust for multiple aircraft applications. It'll save money so we can reinvest in other areas. Another leap-ahead technology we're prioritizing is hypersonics. Once weaponized, it will be a game changer. Hypersonic technology will enable us to better engage in highly contested environments. Speed matters, especially when we need to stand off. Hypersonic weapons will allow us to more effectively address short dwell targets that pop out from cover and then operate and then quickly hide. So we're building on the success of the X51 and investing in foundational technologies necessary to successfully demonstrate a weapon. We're doing this by teaming our AFRL, our Air Force Research Lab, and DARPA with industry partners to mature two approaches to deliver these effects: tactical boost glide and scramjet-powered cruise. We're working to reduce program risk, but we need to move more quickly, and we're pushing to accelerate the prototype. We also need to advance our C2. General Goldfein, his focus on multi-domain command and control is exquisitely timed. Our multi-domain operations are manpower intensive and require extensive coordination. As you've heard here at AFA this week, we need our C2 systems to operate seamlessly and dynamically. And the key to getting there is all about data. It's about getting credible data and using automation to quickly analyze and apply it to decision making. We need to integrate multiple sources of data instantly without much human intervention. We need tools to quickly assess and analyze enormous amounts of information, allowing airmen to spend time thinking and doing rather than searching, reading, and attempting to evaluate. Investment in this area is critical to future combat success. However, I also appreciated Lonnie Cass's comments in the panel yesterday. She cautioned about the risks of automatically integrating large amounts of data. We must find ways to verify that the data is correct, and we need to safeguard against deception and manipulation of ground truth. In the Desert Storm era, there was a big debate about providing sensor-to-shooter information, raw data directly into the cockpit. I was an intelligence analyst, and I spent hours with my intel team poring through and verifying intelligence sources and analyzing raw data to characterize it and correlate it to enemy systems and give pilots the threat laydown. That was what the enemy had and where it was. We built thousands of lines of data manually into tactical orders of battle for targeting and planning. We put our names on it, and we put appropriate caveats where we had gaps and doubts. So we've come a long way in data fusion since then, and we don't want to go back to all that manual work, but we need to make sure that the data that we're using is credible, or it won't be operationally useful. We're also investing in other technology priorities. So what follows is a bit of a laundry list, but it's all very important. We're accelerating investments in directed energy applications. Autonomous learning systems are also important so that our computers learn and adapt. We're investing in human-machine collaboration techniques. And additive manufacturing is an area that may provide leap-ahead opportunities for expeditionary operations and weapon systems, as well as facilities construction and spare parts, not to mention future medical application, which benefits our warriors. Our investments are critical to our future success. So now I want to look a little at basing. What are our basing priorities for the remainder of 2017? We expect to have a few announcements. The MQ-9 basing, a final basing decision on the interim F-16 FTU, preferred locations for two additional F-35 guard locations, and finally we'll announce the preferred location for battlefield airmen training consolidation. Meanwhile, we're looking for ways to partner with communities to free up resources to build a more lethal force. We currently have 56 installations and communities in our program working together on a wide range of initiatives seeking to build on shared services from trash removal to small arms firing ranges. We're investing in energy resiliency for our bases to ensure we can operate when power is interrupted for natural or other reasons. For example, we're investing in cheaper, cleaner sources of power for our bases, and we're also investing in physical hardening overseas. Additionally, we're reviewing business practices to see where automation and robotics can free up manpower and improve performance at our installations. In fact, we now have 76 pharmacies using robotic systems to fill prescriptions with fewer errors, which allowed us to repurpose manpower to other important tasks. Finally, as we look to this coming year, our expected milestones include the first aircraft delivery of KC-46 this fall at McConnell and Altus, awarding our GBSD, LRSO, and TX contracts. We'll release an RFP for C-130 upgrades to address aircraft avionics modernization and ensure fleet viability well into the future. So I want to switch gears and talk about space. The Air Force has been our nation's space steward for over 50 years. It's a responsibility we take seriously. We're still the preeminent nation in space. But more and more nations and commercial interests seek to capitalize on the advantages provided by space. In fact, there's a space gold rush underway. Because of this, we need to update our national space policy to reflect the rapidly changing space environment, and we need to treat it as a warfighting domain. It's no longer a benign environment for government and commercial assets to operate. We need to build a resilient and operationally effective architecture. We have a lot of interest from Congress on space and questions about whether we're organized for success. The GAO produced a report saying 60 different stakeholders can say no on space issues. Believe me, the chief and I know. There are many people that can say no on space issues. But in 2017, in the NDAA, Congress directed DOD to offer recommendations on how to improve the leadership, organization, and management of the enterprise. We're working to answer their questions. To be clear, we want to streamline decision-making as quickly as possible across all fronts, including acquisition. We just can't afford to wait. And fortunately, we're in the middle of a space renaissance. The U.S. commercial industry is driving innovation in areas such as launch, satellite communications, and remote sensing. And through Space Command's Space Enterprise Vision, the Air Force, in collaboration with the NRO, is developing new tactics, techniques, and procedures to enhance our space situational awareness and improve overall C2. As we prepare to answer our congressional task around space governance, you'll see us streamline acquisition processes. You'll see us implement our new NDAA 16 authorities to make milestone decisions on major defense acquisition programs within the Air Force. But as in all warfighting domains, people are the key. We want to attract and retain space talent. Let me highlight an important space-related initiative, and I think you've heard a little bit about it in the last several days. Thanks to a partnership with AFA, we have a program called Stellar Explorers that's offering a challenging space design competition for students. We've had a steady increase in participation as it flourishes into a national-level program. It's grown from 27 teams in 2015 to 125 in 2016. Including 30 states. We're excited to announce the Air Force will provide scholarships to each of the students comprising the first, second, and third place winners. And we're happy to hear United Launch Alliance will match the scholarship amounts. Now I want to touch a little on data and cyberspace. This is a major focus for the year. Our core missions increasingly rely on cyberspace capabilities, which are delivered and protected by world-class Air Force workforce, a workforce we need to grow and retain. Challenges remain, but 2016 was a good year. We stood up a Chief Information Security Office. We cut the ribbon on the Air Force's cyber proving ground, and we've deployed an endpoint security and management tool faster than any other enterprise has done to date. The Air Force's HR talent management suite, called MyPERS, was moved to the cloud in a tremendous partnership with industry. And we've stood up an Air Force digital service in coordination with DOD's digital service. This small team of civilians, they're software geniuses, and they're acting as the pros from Dover, bringing their Silicon Valley experience to help us with our complex software development programs. They're bringing us best practices from outside of DOD to improve areas where we haven't been successful. Our landmark will continue to be the transformation of our communications squadrons in the Cyber Squadron Initiative. This effort fundamentally changes our workforce from IT service providers to mission assurance airmen. And it provides wing commanders a defense cyber operations capability to mitigate risk to their wings' missions. We also recently commissioned a Cyber Resiliency Office for Weapon Systems. Their mission is to press cybersecurity and resiliency into our weapon systems and platforms. We'll continue to work to close gaps in cyber and prepare for data resource management. And we'll continue to encourage an enterprise view for IT. with emphasis on governance, budget, and centralized responsibility. So I've covered a lot, but the most important aspect of our Air Force is our airmen, and they deserve the spotlight as we enter our 70th year. Our people on active duty, civilians, and in the Guard and Reserve are incredibly talented and dedicated. They are what makes the United States Air Force great. The Chief and I are committed to taking care of them. We highly value each person's contributions to the Air Force team, and we respect their needs. Their quality of life is important. We ask a lot from our people, and we're dedicated to taking care of them and their families. Finally, I want to highlight an important program the Chief and I are working to improve. In 2012, the Air Force centralized the Wounded Warrior Program within the Air Force Personnel Center, and we learned a lot. We learned valuable lessons from airmen with physical and invisible wounds. We've done well, but we need to do more for our greatest resource. Treating invisible wounds is our sacred duty, just as it is to treat the wounds we see. We need to better understand the barriers that are preventing airmen from getting help early. We offer a wide range of services, but we need to integrate them so they're accessible to all airmen. We're now looking at ways to address the gaps we've identified in care for wounded airmen, no matter whether they've had one tour or a full career. And where possible, we will champion efforts to get airmen back to duty. The needs are particularly urgent for our battlefield airmen. We need them, and we need each of you, our active Guard, Reserve, and civilian airmen. Some of you are here today. We also need our international partners, and we need our industry partners. It's you who have provided the intellectual and the technological magic that's produced the world's greatest Air Force. We look forward to celebrating our 70th birthday with all of you. Thanks for everything you do for us. And what I want to do is show a very short video on the 70th birthday, Breaking Barriers. Thank you very much. I look forward to working with all of you. Let's roll the video.
Thank you so much, Madam Secretary, for that great presentation and really inspiring video. I want to thank Secretary Disbrow for a great presentation. Thank you all for being here. I know you all will join me and certainly agree with me that regardless of what happens in terms of future confirmations, the Air Force is in good hands with Secretary Disbrow. So thank you all so much. Okay, if you would just sort of break in place and we'll reset the stage for the next panel. Thank you very much.